Good morning, students.
Good morning.
So yesterday we had ended with materials and material cost, how they are to be taken as relevant cost under different circumstances. First, we have seen when they are not in stock, then what do? We take the purchase cost or the current market price, which is required to replace the raw materials. And when they are in stock, then we see whether they are in regular use or not in regular use. If they are in regular use, then again, it will be the cost of replacement, which means again the current cost or the current market price. Secondly, if they are not in regular use but they have a scrap value, that is, we take the or the disposal value. Now, sometimes the scrap value is not there; the disposal value is there. Now, disposal value means it will be a cost, not an inflow of cash. It will be an outflow of cash. So, outflow of cash in the sense that certain chemicals, certain chemical waste, for example. It requires an expenditure to be disposed of. It cannot be disposed of just like that, as we dispose of any other garbage or waste. For example, medicines, the medicinal waste that is there of hospitals, that requires a cost to be disposed of. The hospitals have to pay the municipal authorities some amount of cost for the disposal of the used syringe or now the used PPE kits, which are used by the doctors for treating COVID patients. When they are disposed of, it has to be disposed of with care, and there will be a cost of disposal. That will be an outflow of cash. So you have to take care to see whether it is a scrap value that has been mentioned or whether it is a disposal value. Then if they have alternative use, we said that the relevant cost will be the higher of the realizable value of that particular material or the value in use. That means if it was used for the alternative purpose, and what is the cost of that? Now coming to labor now. Labor cost, how to calculate the relevant labor cost? In the case of materials, we said, okay, fine, we'll see whether the materials are there in the stock or not in the stock. But in case of labor, how do we decide? What is the criteria? In the case of labor, the criteria is whether we are 100% utilizing the labor or we are not utilizing the labor to the extent of 100%. That means, are we operating at full capacity or are we operating at less than full capacity? If we are operating at less than full capacity, then that means there is some idle capacity or there is some spare capacity. Okay? If there is some idle capacity or spare capacity, then how the cost will be calculated, that will be different from when there is no spare capacity. Okay, no spare capacity in the sense that we are fully utilizing the labor force to the extent of 100%. So let us see the two cases. The first case, I'll refer back to our document. Okay, you can see that spare capacity exists and spare capacity does not exist in both these cases. First, if the spare capacity exists, that means we are not operating 100%. Okay, now here there are two possible cases. If there is a spare capacity and there is a condition, if there is a spare capacity and there is a condition that the existing labor cost, labor, should be first utilized. Because they are sitting idle, they are not doing anything. So first my existing labor should be taken into consideration. Then if I require more than that, I may hire additional labor. But if there is no condition that the existing labor should be utilized first, then I can make use of casual labor. So let us go with the first assumption. Existing workers are to be utilized first. Okay? So let us say a factory is paying its workers, each worker, 20,000 rupees per month for operating at 100% capacity. But it is not utilizing the labor for 100% capacity. So they are not working for 8 hours a day, 30 days a month. They are working only for 5 hours a day. So they are idle for 3 hours per day, every day. Now the labor union has got into a contract with the factory, with the company, that if you are going to make use of, if there is any other work that is to be done, then first my existing labor should be utilized. That is, the remaining 3 hours of my existing labor should be utilized before I can hire outside labor. So I cannot make my labor sit in the factory doing nothing and hire outsiders to do my job. Okay, so that is the first condition. If that is the case, then for the additional work that I'm utilizing this labor force, I don't have to pay them anything. I don't have to pay them anything additional because they are already being paid, no? 20,000 I'm already paying them, and I'm not utilizing them for 8 hours in a day. I'm utilizing them only for 5 hours. So if I utilize them for the remaining 3 hours, they can't demand additional cost or premium or overtime cost. No, they can't, because I'm utilizing them to the 100%. Okay. So in case where I am utilizing my existing labor, in that case, I have to pay no additional cost if the same labor is being utilized for some other work. Clear? Second case, where I am having casual labor, that means they are not my regular workers, they are on contract basis. Casual labor means contract basis. If I am utilizing this contract labor or the casual labor, then when the company accepts an additional order, then there will be labor cost incurred. Okay. So that additional labor cost that is going to be incurred will be calculated on the wage rate that is paid to them on an hourly basis. So that will be the relevant cost. So if spare capacity exists and I'm utilizing my existing labor force, no additional cost to be paid. Now it happens many times, you know, in colleges. What happens is a teacher is paid, let us say, 25,000 per month. Okay, a teacher is paid 25,000 per month. Now normally when the teachers are employed, they are employed on full-time basis. So they are told full-time basis, you are going to work in the college, you have to come in the morning at 7 o'clock till 12 o'clock, that is till the college is there, you have to remain in college, maybe till 3 o'clock, sometimes till 3 o'clock. So in Bangalore, we used to have some colleges like Jain University, etc., where we used to have colleges employing teachers from 7 o'clock in the morning to 3 o'clock in the evening. So 7 to 12, they will be having lectures, and from 12 to 3, they will be doing some administrative work. So they are contracted for that. I mean, they are employed for that. They are full-time teachers. They are called as full-time teachers. But they may not have lectures continuously from 7 to 12. A teacher may have lecture only for 3 hours per day. So the teacher, he or she, may be employed for 3 lectures, where I can give them 5 lectures of 1 hour each. During a particular day, every teacher may be having just 3 lectures. Some teachers may be having full 5 lectures. Some teachers may be having only 3 lectures. Some teachers may be having just 2 lectures per day. But their salary is fixed. I pay them 25,000 per month. Now, if a teacher who was originally taken 3 hours per day, 3 lectures per day, if I give the teacher 2 additional lectures, I don't have to pay the teacher more. Why? The reason is that I'm already paying her for full-time basis. That is for the five hours. Now, out of that 5 hours, I was utilizing only 3 hours. So if I give her additional 2 hours lectures, I don't have to pay her more. Okay, so that is the criteria with which we are going to work. So where existing teachers are, or existing labor is to be used for the additional work or for the new work, then in that case, there is no additional cost. But where casual labor is employed, then I may have to have cost incurred, because casual labor is paid normally on hourly basis. Case B is where full capacity is utilized. All my workers are 100% employed. Okay, then in that case, if additional work is taken up by the company, then either I have to go for overtime cost, because then I will have to ask the laborers to work overtime, and then I will have to charge the additional order with overtime cost. Okay. Second, in the case where let us say that overtime is not possible. Okay, if there is no overtime possible, then the additional order that I'm having can be accepted only if I sacrifice my existing production. Only if I sacrifice my existing production. So, if there is full capacity, that means my workers are fully employed, 100% employed. They don't have any time. They are not having any free time. Then in that case, what will happen is, I have to see whether they can work overtime. If yes, then that additional order will be charged with overtime cost. If overtime is not possible, okay, if overtime is not possible at all, and we are working 100%, then in that case, for accepting the new order, I will have to sacrifice my existing production. So if my existing production is sacrificed, then what will be the relevant cost? Then in that case, the relevant cost will be the normal labor hours, that is the normal labor cost, plus an opportunity cost, that is in the form of contribution lost on my existing production. So the labor cost, the relevant labor cost will be the normal labor cost that is incurred, whatever is the normal wages paid to the worker, plus an opportunity cost, which is equivalent to the contribution cost. So that is given to you in the relevant labor cost. Now, with the help of this, I have given you some two examples are given here. So let us just go through the two examples. One is on materials. So let us go through this example. X Limited has been approached. Actually, Akhil, there is an audio problem. There is some internet disparity going on. That means sometimes the internet is going down low. Mm-hmm. So when the internet is low, there will be breaking in voice.
From 5 minutes onwards, sir.
Yeah. So there is some, you will find some disturbance because the internet fluctuations are there. Wi-Fi fluctuations are there. So when the Wi-Fi is weak, the voice is getting affected. Audio is getting affected.
Okay.
Akhil is frozen now. Hence, I think he is having some audio-video problem. Am I clear? Is the audio video clear now? Hello. Is the audio video clear? Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Very good.
let us start with the example. We'll just go through the example. X Limited has been approached by a customer who would like a special job to be done for him. He is willing to pay 25,000 for it. The job would require the following materials. Now he has given the different materials required.
అశోక్ నువ్వు మ్యూట్ లో పెట్టుకోవచ్చు స్టార్టింగ్ లో నువ్వు తెలుసా అది
కాదు నాకు డిస్టర్బెన్స్ వస్తుంది నా ఒక్క మీద లీవ్ క్లాస్
చూసినావు కొంచెం చూసుకో
ఏ ప్రవీణ్ రాలేదు
సంటైమ్స్ అశోక్ లుక్స్ లైక్ టిపికల్ పొలిటీషియన్ ఎస్ అశోక్ ఇంట్రెస్టెడ్ ఇన్ పాలిటిక్స్
No, sir.
You can be a typical politician. You know, your face cut and everything is like that on your profile. CMA will be additional qualification for this politician. The way you sit, the style with which you sit, like, you know, it is like royally. Let us look at the question now. So we are having four materials A, B, C, D. The required quantity is given 1000, 1000, 1000 and 200. Now you can see that. What is given as required over here? 1000 units are required. But nothing is there in stock. So yesterday we had done, if nothing is there in stock, if it is not there in stock, then what to do? Then replacement cost. Now here 1000 units are there, out of which 600 is in stock. Okay, requirement is 1000, 600 is in stock, so 400 is not in stock. So for 600 how much? For 400 how much? That we have to see. And if it is in stock also, whether it is regularly used or not regularly used, that we have to see. Okay. And material C, we require 1000, only 700 is there in stock, so 300 is not there in stock. Material D, 200 is required, entire 200 is in stock. But now the latter part is important. Material B is regularly used by X, regularly used. And if B is required for this job, they would need to be replaced. So if you are using this 600 units, you have to go for the replacement cost. Okay. Material C and D are in stock as a result of previous overbuying and they have a restricted use. There is no other use for material C. No other use for material C. Okay. But material D could be used. That means alternative uses there. As substitute for 300 units of material E, which currently costs 5 rupees per unit. So if I'm taking, let us see now how to find out the cost. Material A, 1000 units are required, nothing is there in stock. So I will be taking the replacement cost of 6 rupees per unit. So for this material A, the replacement cost is a relevant cost. Because entire 1000 units I have to purchase from market. Replacement cost is market cost, market price. Okay. So entire 1000 units I'll have to purchase from the open market. And the cost for that is 6 rupees. Achha, second one, B, 1000 units, out of which 600 are in stock. 400 is not in stock. And 600, whatever is there, is regularly used by X Limited. So they need to be replaced. So replacement cost. So for this 600 also, it will be 5 units. So what about the 400? 400 has to be purchased from outside. What is the outside price, market price? That is also 5 units. Correct. So entire 1,000 units will be valued at 5 rupees. Now let us come to material C. 1,000 units are required. 700 is in stock. But what they have said is that there is no other use for material C. There is no other use for material C. But it can be sold as scrap. Scrap value is 2.5. Okay. Material C, 1,000 units required, out of which 700 are already in stock, but 700 is not required by the company for any other use. So if I don't use it, it will be sold as scrap and company will get cash inflow of 2.5 per unit. So for the company, that is a relevant cost. So 700 units will be valued at 2.5 scrap value. Achha, what about the remaining 300 that I require? The remaining 300 that I require, I will purchase from open market. What is the open market price? Open market price is 4 rupees. So 300 units at 4 rupees and 700 units at 2.5. Okay, that is clear. Now, material D. Material D, 200 units are required and I have the full 200 units in stock. But what they have said for material D, it can be used in another job as substitute. So that means there is an alternative use for this. Alternative use. Achha, now, if no other details are given, then I would say whatever is the value of those materials or the value in use, higher of the two will be taken. Now, if you go to see, they have further given. It is used as substitute for 300 units of material E, which currently costs 5 rupees per unit. Understand what I'm saying? These 200 units are actually going to be used for another purpose, for another job, which requires 300 units of material E at a cost of 5 rupees per unit. So if I use these 200 units for the other job, I will be not purchasing material E. Okay. But if I use these 200 units for my new job, then for that other alternative job, I will have to purchase 300 units of that new material at 5 rupees per unit. So what is the cost of this material D? Is the cost that I'm now going to pay for purchasing material E at 5 rupees per unit. So cost of material D will be 300 into 5, 300 units into 5 rupees per unit. That will be the cost of material D. It is not 200, it will be 300 units at 5 rupees. Now you will say, why 300, sir, why not 200? Because 300 units are required to be purchased instead of 200 now. If I am utilizing material D, I will require only 200 units. But if I don't utilize material D, maybe that I am going to purchase material E, which is of inferior quality. So I require more units of E. That is, I require 300 units of E to be purchased at 5 rupees per unit to replace 200 units of E. Okay. So in that way, I will be calculating the material cost, which is coming to 15,450. And since the customer is willing to pay 25,000, I have a profit. profit, which is the difference between 25,000 and 15,400. Okay, so a simple problem I have taken here. Let us now take one more with labor cost. Labor cost. Let us not look at the solution. Let us see the question only and see if we can answer. They are saying state whether the following are relevant or not relevant and the resultant cash flow if the project is undertaken. Okay, so what will be the cash flow and whether it is a relevant cost or irrelevant cost? 3 new employees will be taken at a cost of 1 lakh each for a new project. So first of all, relevant cash flow means future cash flow. So is it future or is it already paid? It is a future cost because I'm taking new employees and each one of them I'm paying 1 lakh. So there is a cash outflow. So 1 lakh into 3 lakhs will be the relevant cost. Okay. Second one, one employee earning rupees 1 lakh would be considered redundant. That is not required. Okay, but would be receiving 60,000 rupees as a redundant pay. Meaning that one employee is found to be, you know, totally outdated, is not suitable for the job. He cannot do the job. But if I remove him, the trade union is not going to allow me. Okay, so since the trade union is not going to allow me to remove him, I have to keep him in the company. And as a result of that, I will not be paying him 1 lakh. I will be paying him only 60,000 as a redundant pay. So is that relevant or not relevant? Answer is yes, it is relevant because instead of paying him 1 lakh, I am now paying him only 60,000. So there is a savings of cash outflow to the extent of 40,000. Savings in cash outflow of rupees 40,000. Okay, how do I explain that 40,000? I will not be paying him 1 lakh. So there is a savings in cost of 1 lakh. But there is an additional cost payable as a redundant cost of 60,000. So instead of paying him 1 lakh, I am paying him 60,000. So 40,000 is my savings in outflow of cash. Okay, third one. A supervisor earning 75,000 rupees would spend 25% of his total time on the new project. No additional payment will be made. Very clear. So is there any future cash flow? Answer is no. There is no future cash flow. Since there is no future cash outflow or inflow, it is an irrelevant cost. Because we are already paying him 75,000. Now whether he spends 25% of his time on the project or 50% of the time on the project, it is a matter of allocation. It is a matter of allocation. I'm not incurring any additional expense. Okay. So there is no additional payment. It is an irrelevant cost. Next one. Deepa. Material already in stock, which cost rupees 10,000 to dispose of, will be used for a new project. As I told you, harmful chemicals wastage, when they are to be disposed of, medical wastage like used syringes, used gloves by the doctors, then the PPE kits that are now being used for COVID treatment of patients, all that when it is used and discarded, there is a cost of disposal. There is a cost of disposal. Okay. Now let us come to some chemicals. Chemicals which are waste, we have to dispose them off. So I am going to incur 10,000 rupees to dispose of the chemicals which are there in my stock. I have to incur an expenditure of 10,000. If I use this chemical for my new project, what will happen? I don't have to pay 10,000 for disposal. That means there is a savings in cost. So it is a future event. Answer is yes. So it is relevant. Cash flows are saved to the extent of 10,000. Outflow of cash is saved to the extent of 10,000. Okay. So it is a relevant cost and the relevant cost will be savings in cost to the extent of 10,000. Next one, machine costing 12 lakhs purchased 5 years ago. Purchased 5 years ago has a current value of 3 lakhs and it will be used in the new project. Now I had purchased a machine paying 12 lakhs 5 years ago, but since I didn't want that machine, it was lying unused. After depreciation, the current value of the machine is 3 lakhs. Now that machine which was lying unused in my company, I'm utilizing that machine in my new project. Will there be a relevant cost? Answer is no. Because 12 lakhs, whatever has been paid, it has been paid in the past. It is not a future cash outflow. So it is irrelevant. It is a sunk cost. 3 lakhs which is there, 3 lakhs which is there, which is the current value, okay, which is the current value. If nothing has been done with that asset, I can sell that machine for 3 lakhs. Okay, I can sell that machine for 3 lakhs. So there is a saleable value, current value, saleable value. So to the extent of 3 lakhs, there is a relevant cash flow. So 12 lakhs is irrelevant, but 3 lakhs is relevant because had I sold that machine as of today, I could have earned an inflow of cash to the extent of 3 lakhs. Okay, so this is how we calculate the relevant and irrelevant cost of a particular material or of labor. So now we have problems based on relevant costing specifically. So let us take up those problems one by one. All answers are given to you. Let us take question number one. A company can produce any of its four products A, B, C, and D. Only one product can be produced in a production period. And this has to be determined at the beginning of the year, at the beginning of the production run. The production capacity is 1,000 hours. Production capacity is 1,000 hours. Whatever is produced has to be sold. And there is no inventory buildup to be considered beyond the production period. So that means there is no opening or closing stock. Okay. Selling price per unit is given to you. Variable cost per unit is given to you. Number of units that can be sold, that is given. Number of production hours required per unit is also given. 1 hour, 15 minutes. 1 hour, 15 minutes and 2 hours. What are the opportunity costs of A, B, C and D? Okay, first of all, what is the meaning of opportunity cost? Let us try to understand that. Opportunity cost, yesterday we had not done. So let us come back to opportunity cost. We had done incremental cost and differential cost yesterday. So let us come back to that. SEMA has defined opportunity cost as the value of the benefit sacrificed when course of action is taken. This we all know. Opportunity cost means whatever has been sacrificed, whatever has been foregone in preference to an alternative. But what we have to know now is the opportunity cost is represented by the foregone potential benefit from the best rejected course of action. This is important for you. So please underline this. And if possible, you can highlight this also. Best rejected course of action. Okay. Now, what is the meaning of this? You know, what is the meaning of this? Suppose if I'm producing a particular commodity by using a particular raw material, and by that particular raw material can be utilized for some other product also, and I could have got a contribution of, if I'm producing product X, I would have got a contribution of 30 rupees per unit. if I'm producing Y, then I could have got a contribution of 35 rupees per unit. Now this is the opportunity cost. I'm using that for that material for production of commodity A. So what is the opportunity cost for me? The opportunity cost is the cost of not producing X, which is a loss of contribution of 30 rupees per unit, or not producing Y, which results in a loss of contribution of 35 rupees. So which one will I take? Yes, the best rejected course of action. Which is the best rejected course of action? I could have got best or a maximum 35 rupees per unit as contribution. So what is my opportunity cost? Not 30 rupees, but 35 rupees. The higher of the two. So opportunity cost of the best rejected course of action. Okay. So I have rejected X also, I have rejected Y also. But out of that, what is the best possible course of action that I rejected? Why? Because that was giving me higher contribution. So the higher contribution lost is my opportunity cost. Okay, so that is the meaning of best rejected course of action. Very important point. Opportunity cost exists because resources are scarce. If resources are not scarce, then there will be no sacrifice. Then I can produce everything. Isn't it? Opportunity cost exists because resources have alternative use. If no alternative use is there, then there is no opportunity cost. Okay, so this is what I want you to remember for today's problems. Opportunity cost is the worst scenario. Best rejected course of action is worst scenario. Means what? The maximum contribution lost. Maximum contribution lost. That's the worst scenario, no? And that is the best option that I've rejected. That is the best option that I've rejected. So, coming back to the question now. When they have said that we have to calculate the opportunity cost, how do we calculate the opportunity cost for this? Question is asking me to calculate the opportunity cost. What are the opportunity costs of A, B, C, and D? So let us see how to work out this. Very important, very exciting example. Because what we have to see is which is the maximum amount of loss that we are going to suffer. That is my opportunity cost. Maximum contribution lost or a maximum cost that is going to be incurred. Okay, so like that. So let us prepare a statement. Statement showing opportunity cost. Estimated time required. Estimated time required. For product A, I require 1 hour per unit. For product B, it is 1 hour 15 minutes. So I will take it as 15 minutes, I will take it as 1.25 hours. 15 minutes is 1/4 of an hour. Okay, so 1/4 of an hour means 0.25. C is again 1 hour 15 minutes, so 1.25. hours. And D is 2 hours. maximum production capacity for the company's machines 1000 hours. Maximum production capacity. So maximum production possible tell me how much 1000 divided by 1
1000
units
1000
1000 divided by 1.25
800
units same over here 800 units and last one it will be 1000 divided by 2
500
Okay, what is the actual demand? Actual demand, number of units that can be sold, 1000 units. So that means all 1000 units of A can be sold. For B, it is 600 units. For C, it is 900 units. And for D, it is 600 units. Okay. So now, by comparing this, I'll come to the point. Actual production. And a sale. Actual production and a sale. Comparing the two, maximum production possible and actual demand, whichever is less. First case it is 1000 units only. 800 or 600, whichever is less, 600 units. 800 or 900, whichever is less, 800 units. 500 or 600 units, whichever is less, so 500 units. Contribution per unit, selling price minus variable cost, production A, product A, 40 minus 30, $50 minus $20, $60 minus $20, and $70 minus $30. Total contribution earned. Thousand into 10. 10,000. 600 into 30. 18,000. 800 into 40. 32,000. And 500 into 40. 20,000. Now I calculate opportunity cost. Okay, now see how I'm going to calculate opportunity cost. Very interesting. If I produce product A, I cannot produce B, C, and D. Okay? Out of B, C, and D, which is having maximum contribution? Which is having
maximum contribution?
So I say that if I produce A, the maximum contribution that I lose is 32,000. So 32,000 becomes my opportunity cost of A. Okay. Now, if I produce B, I will not be producing A, C, and D. Again, out of A, C, and D, which has got highest contribution? Again, 32,000, C. So it will be 32,000 here also. If I produce C, I will not be producing A, B, and D. Which is the highest contribution here?
D.
D, 20,000. So that will be my opportunity cost. If I'm producing A, if I'm producing D, I will not be able to produce A, B, or C. Highest contribution there is 32,000.
32,000.
This is how we calculate the opportunity cost. So let us write down.
Sir, I have a doubt.
Yeah.
In case of B, we have leftover hours for production, right?
We have taken the hours into consideration.
But we have leftover because there is not that much demand for the 100% production to be sold off.
Irrespective of that. So,
why can't we use that extra amounts to produce the next best opportunity?
So next best opportunity will be the contribution lost. We don't go in the on the basis of number of hours. On the basis of number hours or number of hours, we have calculated the contribution.
Okay.
So once we do that, the highest contribution lost that will be taken. Okay. Let us write down. Opportunity cost is the maximum possible contribution foregone. By not producing, by not producing alternative products. Next line, right? If product A is manufactured, then maximum loss of contribution is rupees 32,000. Similarly, If product B is manufactured, then maximum loss of contribution is rupees 32,000. Accordingly, For product C, it is 20,000. For product C, it is 20,000. And for product D, it is 32,000. For a product D, it is 32,000. Let us take question number 2. A company has to decide whether to accept a special order or not for a certain product M, in respect of which the following information is given. So they have given materials required as well as the labor required. And for each one, we have to calculate and see what is going to be the relevant cost. So this is a problem of relevant costing. Material is required to the extent of 5,000 kgs. But what is the status of material A? It is available in stock. Available in stock. That means that it is there in stock. It was purchased 5 years ago at 35 rupees per kg, and if not used for M, it can be sold as scrap at 15 rupees per kg. that means that A is there in stock, but it is not in regular use, and it would be sold if it is not used as scrap at 15 rupees. So if I use it for the production of M, product M, then in that case, I will not be getting the scrap value of 15 rupees per kg. So there is loss of cash inflow to the extent of 15 rupees per kg. Okay, that is the scrap value. So that will be the relevant cost of 5,000 units. The relevant cost of 5,000 units will be 5,000 into 15. Okay, 75,000. Second one, material B required is 8,000 kgs. This has to be purchased at 25 rupees per kg from the market. That means it is not in stock. Not in stock. I purchase it from the market. So the cost will be 8,000 into 25. It's a cash flow. Right? Third one, hardware items, 10,000. They have directly given. So that means other hardware items have to directly purchase from the open market. So 10,000 will be the relevant cost. Now we come to certain labor. It's labor oriented. Department X is labor oriented. Now what they have said is requirement is 5 men for 1 month at the rate of 7,000 per month per person. What is the status of labor? Labor is to be freshly hired, no spare capacity available. No spare capacity available. So that means I will have to pay them. The relevant cost will be 7,000 rupees per month for 5 workers to multiply by 5. Fine. Department Y, machine oriented, machine hours. I require 3,000 machine hours at 5 rupees per machine hour. 3,000 machine hours at 5 rupees per machine hour. To be in existing spare capacity may be utilized. Spare capacity is there. So will I incur additional cost? I will not incur additional cost. So there will be no additional cost, because it is already there within the spare capacity. So do I have to pay 3,000 into 5? I don't have to pay 3,000 into 5. 15,000 is not to be paid. Next one, patterns and specifications, 15,000 rupees. To be incurred for M specifically, that means that is a future cash outflow, 15,000. But after the order, it can be sold for 2,000. That means after it is used for that particular order, of production of M. It can be sold for 2000. So what is the cost? 15 minus 2. That is 13,000 will be the relevant cost. Okay. Considering the relevant cost, find out the minimum value above which the company may accept the order. This is the question. Achha, how we have to write the answer? For every point, we have to write the explanation first and then prepare a statement showing the total cost. Okay. So let us first write down the explanations to each of those points. So write down the answer. Write point number one. Point number one. Material A is already in stock. Material A is already in stock. If it is not used for product M, if it is not used for product M, it can be sold. If it is not used for a product M, it can be sold. Therefore, the scrap value likely to be lost. The scrap value likely to be lost if used in production of M. If used in production of M, will be the relevant cost. Will be the relevant cost. Second point. Purchase cost of material B. Purchase cost of material B is a future cost. Is a future cost which will be incurred. Which will be incurred for the production of M. For the production of M. Therefore, it is a relevant cost. Therefore, it is a relevant cost. Third point. Hardware items to be purchased. Hardware items to be purchased. Rupees 10,000 is also a future cost. Is also a future cost to be incurred for the manufacture of M. To be incurred for the manufacture of M. Therefore, rupees 10,000 is a relevant cost. Rupees 10,000 is a relevant cost. Fourth point. Department X requires. Department X requires freshly hired labor. Freshly hired labor. Therefore, the labor cost of rupees 7,000 per month. Of rupees 7,000 per month. Is a relevant cost. Is a relevant cost. Point number five. Department Y, which is machine oriented, which is machine oriented, has spare capacity, which is machine oriented, has a spare capacity, which will now be utilized. Which will now be utilized. However, cost of machine hours will not be a relevant cost. Will not be a relevant cost. Since it is already incurred, and now only apportioned. Next one, patterns and specifications. Patterns and specifications are relevant costs. Patterns and specifications are relevant costs. Because they are incurred specifically for product M. They are incurred specifically for product M. However, it will realize rupees 2000. At the end of the production. Therefore, the net amount should be considered. As a relevant cost. Okay, let us prepare the statement now. Statement showing relevant cost. Starting with cost of material A. Cost of material A 15,000, 15 rupees into 5,000. So 5,000 into 15, 75,000. Cost of material B, 8,000 into 25. ₹2 lakhs. Cost of hardware items. ₹10,000. labor cost of department X. Five into one into 7,000. 35,000. Patterns and specifications. Net cost we have to do. Patterns and specifications. $15,000 minus $2,000. Total relevant cost. So they have asked, find out the minimum value above which the company may accept the order. So company may accept any order where the customer is willing to pay more than 3,33,000. So minimum value is 3,33,000. So company may accept the order above rupees 3,33,000. We'll take a small 5 minutes break and then we'll continue with question 3. 5 minutes break. So let us continue with question number 3. Similar question. Company has decided to launch a new product X, which is expected to have a demand of 10,000 units during the year at rupees 160 per unit. So demand for product X is 10,000, selling price is 160. Following information is furnished by the company. Material. The manufacturer of one unit of X requires one unit of each of materials A, B, and C. They have given you the details of the raw materials, how much is in stock, the cost per unit, original cost, current purchase price, and the resale value. For A, it is regularly used in stock 10,000 units, original cost 16, current purchase price 20, resale value 14. For B, it is old stock, not in use. The first one is regularly used. This is not in use. 6,000 units are there. Original cost was 28. Current purchase price is 24. Resale value is 8. New stock. Current purchase, 48. Direct labor, skilled labor is paid at 80 rupees per hour. So, skilled labor paid at 80 rupees per hour. takes 0.25 hours per unit. Skilled labor has to be drawn from another production which has a contribution of 240 per unit, with each unit requiring 2 hours of skilled labor. So contribution lost over there will become the relevant cost for this. Okay, that is for skilled labor. So it will be skilled labor will be, that is direct labor will be, the rate per hour plus the loss of contribution. Unskilled labor, 2 hours per unit at 56 rupees per hour. There is abundant unskilled labor in the factory, but according to an agreement with the labor union, no unskilled labor can be retrenched. So if you remember, I told you when we were doing the labor cost, labor relevant cost, I told you today that if there is abundant labor and there is a trade union agreement with you that you have to use the existing labor before you can use the outside labor. So if you are using the existing labor, you don't have to pay them anything extra because you are already being paid now. They are not utilized fully. So now when you are utilizing them fully, you don't have to pay them anything extra. So unskilled labor cost will not be a relevant cost. Okay. Third one, variable overheads are 10 rupees per unit. Variable overheads 10 rupees per unit. It's a relevant cost. Fixed overheads, using relevant cost approach, you are required to find out the average variable cost per unit of X. Okay, so as I said, first we have to write down the explanations of all the things, what we are going to make use of, how much we are going to make use of, and then we can prepare the statement. So let us write down the notes first. Point number one, tell me now, for material A, I require 10,000 units. See, what they have given is manufacture of one unit of X requires one unit of each of materials A, B, and C. Okay. So for producing 10,000 units of product X, I require 10,000 units of A, and A is in regular use. So if I'm utilizing A, then I will have to go for the replacement cost. Replacement cost of A is the current purchase price, 20 rupees. Okay. As far as B is concerned, I require 10,000 units of B, but in stock I have got only 6,000. Okay. So 6,000, it is not in regular use. That means I would have sold it. And if I had sold it, I would have sold it for what value? 8 rupees. So this 6,000 is at 8 rupees. What about the balance 4,000? Balance 4,000 I will have to purchase at 24 rupees. Balance 4,000 at 24 rupees. Current cost from the outside market. Okay. Next one. Cost of C, entire amount, 48 rupees into 10,000 units. 48 into 10,000. 10,000 at 48. Direct skilled labor. Skilled labor. We have said that direct skilled labor, it is going to be 0.25 hours per unit. So I will be requiring around 2,500 hours. Okay, 2,500 hours. And this will be at what rate? Cost of direct labor. At the loss of contribution. Loss of contribution is how much? Loss of contribution is 240 per unit, where each unit is requiring 2 hours. So how much is per hour? It is 240 per unit of 2 hours. So divide by 2, it is 120 per hour. Correct? Huh? So 2,500 hours multiplied by 120 rupees per hour will be the cost of direct labor. Okay? 2,500 hours into 120 rupees per hour. That is the cost of direct labor. Then variable overheads, 10 rupees per unit into 10,000 units. Fine. Let us write down the points now. Point number one. material A is available in stock. Material A is available in stock. But it is regularly used in production. But it is regularly used in production. Therefore, the replacement cost, that is current purchase price is the relevant cost. Current purchase price is the relevant cost. Second part. Material B, comma, 10,000 units are required for production. 10,000 units are required for production. Full stop. 6,000 units are already in stock. 6,000 units are already in stock. But not in regular use. Therefore, their resale value of rupees 14 per unit. Resale value of rupees 8 per unit will be the relevant cost. Full stop. The balance 4,000 units need to be purchased at rupees 24 per unit. Third point. Direct labor, that is skilled labor for 10,000 units, comma, is required to the extent of 2,500 hours. Full stop. Since it is drawn from other production, the loss of contribution per hour will be the relevant cost. The loss of contribution per hour will be the relevant cost. Full stop. The loss of contribution is rupees 240 per unit. The loss of contribution is rupees 240 per unit, requiring two hours. Therefore, loss of contribution per hour is rupees 120. unskilled labor. Unskilled labor. Is available in abundant supply. Is available in abundant supply. Therefore, they will be used. They will be used at no additional cost. At no additional cost. Point number five. Variable overheads at rupees 10 per unit. At rupees 10 per unit will result in future cash flows. Will result in future cash flows. Therefore, it is a relevant cost. Therefore, it is a relevant cost. So, prepare the statement of relevant cost, statement showing relevant cost. Starting with cost of material A. Cost of material A, 10,000 into 20 is 2 lakhs. Cost of material B. $6,000 into $8,000 inside I'll show $48,000 and $4,000 into $24,000 $4,000 into $24,000 is $96,000 $130,000 and $14,000 $144,000 so 1,44,000. Cost of skilled labor, sorry, cost of material C. Cost of material C. 10,000 units into 48. $4,80,000. Cost of skilled labor. $2,500 at 120 per hour. $3,00,000. Variable overheads. $10,000 into $10,000 That is 1,00,000. So that comes to 12,24,000 Now they have asked us to calculate the average variable cost per unit. So average variable cost per unit. Is equal to 1,24,000 divided by 10,000 units. $122.4 per unit. Now we'll do question number 4. Question number 4, you will do it just now and tell me the answer. It is similar to the first problem, calculating the opportunity cost. A company can make any one of the three products X, Y, or Z in a year. It can exercise the option at the beginning of each year. Relevant information about the products for the next year is given. Selling price per unit, variable cost per unit, market demand, production capacity in units, fixed cost. You are required to compute the opportunity cost for each of the products. Chalo, calculate and prepare the statement. Particulars and three columns, X, Y, and Z. Exactly in the same way as you have done for question number 1. Tell me the answer. I give you 5 minutes.
$6,000, $8,000, $8,000.
So everybody has got the answer. 6, 8 and 8. 6,000 for X. 8,000 for Y. 8,000 for Z. Done? Let us go for question number 5. QuickComp is a successful version of a software package that is widely used. FasterComp is the next version for which the development is complete and it is ready to be sold immediately in the market as budgeted. However, for FasterComp, user manuals, training modules, and diskettes have not yet been made. Whereas for the QuickComp version, there are overstocked by 5,000 units. Release of FasterComp will render the QuickComp version not saleable. So you have an old version of the software and a new version of the software. Old version, a lot of stock is lying unsold to the extent of 5,000 units. For the new version, you have yet to prepare the user manuals, the training modules and the disks. The following data is provided. Selling price per unit is given 14,000 and 19,000. Variable cost per unit consisting of user manuals, training modules and disks 1,000 and 4,000. Development cost per unit is given. Marketing and administration cost per unit, that is fixed budgeted annual outflow divided by expected sales quantity for each product of the year is given. Total cost per unit is given and operating income per unit is given. Purely from a financial perspective, the company wants your advice whether to delay the release of the new version by 2 months, by when the inventory of the existing version will be sold, or to release the new version immediately. Support your advice with the relevant figures. I give you 2 minutes. Tell me how to start the problem and what will be the answer. If you can work out, you can work out and tell me the answer also. It hardly takes about 5 minutes to solve, 2 to 5 minutes to solve. Go through the data and tell me whether we should come out with the new version immediately or we should wait for 2 months till the old stock is over. And support your answer with calculations. Should the new version be released immediately or should we wait for 2 months?
Sir, answer 5,000.
Answer is
5,000. Incremental profit.
5,000. What is 5,000?
Sales minus variable.
Sales minus variable cost. Sales minus variable cost is 19 minus 4. That is 15,000.
15,000. 14 minus 1 is 11,000.
14 minus 1 is 13,000.
Wait.
No.
I think we should start by finding out the amount of sales or market demand.
No, we have to find out the contribution only. So, first of all, variable cost of QuickComp Limited, QuickComp version, will that be reduced from the selling price to calculate the contribution? Yes or no? Tell me, yes or no? To calculate the contribution of QuickComp, will we reduce 1,000 from 14,000?
Yes, sir.
No. Why? Because I've always told you, relevant cost is a future cash outflow. And what are you told in the question? You are told in the question that what is that 1,000 variable cost? It is consisting of user manuals, training modules, and disks. Now, if you see the question, they have said that for the QuickComp version, they are overstocked by 5,000 units. It is already there. It is manufactured and kept. It is already lying in the godown. So, will it be a future cash flow? No, it is already incurred. It is a sunk cost. It is already incurred. If I had to incur for the sales, then it would be a future cash flow. So always all variable cost or not relevant cost. Okay. All variable costs are not relevant cost. If the variable cost has already been incurred, then how can you take it as a relevant cost? It is not relevant in my decision making process at all because I've already incurred that cost. Now, whether I sell those 5,000 units or not, it is of no use. It is of no use because in future, I'm not going to incur any cost, any cash flow. Isn't it? So the variable cost that is there on the QuickComp version is a sunk cost. What about the development cost? That is also a sunk cost. What about the marketing and administration cost? That is a fixed cost. It is irrelevant cost. So nothing is going to be taken. Isn't it? So I will be taking 14,000 minus nil as the contribution. So 14,000 as a contribution for QuickComp. For FasterComp, it is 19 minus 4. That is 15,000. Okay? So write down first. Write down. Point number one. Variable cost of QuickComp version. is a sunk cost and therefore it is irrelevant second point development cost development cost of QuickCom is a fixed cost. Is a fixed cost and also a sunk cost. Therefore, it is an irrelevant cost. Therefore, it is an irrelevant cost. Third point, fixed marketing or administration cost. Fixed marketing or administration cost. Is an irrelevant cost. Is an irrelevant cost. Okay. Now you write. QuickCom and FasterCom. Selling price. Per unit. 14,000 and 19,000. Minus variable cost per unit. 1,000, sorry, nil. And 4,000. So this will be 14,000. This will be 15,000. So you are getting 1,000 more over here as contribution for faster pump. 1,000 more per unit. So how many units you want to sell? 5,000 units. Okay. So write down incremental profit, or you can say incremental contribution. Is equal to 15,000 minus 14,000. That is equal to 1,000. For 5,000 units. It is equal to 1,000 into 5,000. ₹50 lakhs. Hence, it is advisable to release the new version FasterCom. Since it results in additional contribution. Results in additional contribution of this 50 lakhs. Okay. So we'll stop here for today. continue on Monday evening 6 o'clock.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.